Yes, sir.
Please, just a moment, I'll enable you. Please start sharing.
Yes.
Very nice.
Very warm good evening to everybody. A very special token of appreciation and thanks to Dr. Dinesh Mathur, Dr. U.S. Agarwal, and my own dear friend and mentor in textbook literature, Dr. Lalit Gupta, for having invited me over to this very august group of being the faculty in this wonderful PGNR. I'm overwhelmed by the amount of hospitality that is being shown even in the virtual world by Professor Dinesh Mathur in the form of bouquets, the turbans, the floral things. That is something very unique. I think that's a hallmark of Dr. Dinesh Mathur over the conferences that I have seen. Thank you very much, sir, for honoring both of us. This is a topic probably the senior members of the profession would appreciate. And the effort here has been to bring on an awareness to the younger postgraduates about how dermatoses were managed earlier and whether those older drugs can still be revisited, given that many of the modern day research is pharma driven and experience-based and anecdotal medicine has actually taken a back seat. Everybody wants some amount of evidence for everything that is prescribed. Not that evidence-based medicine is bad, but these drugs have stood the test of time, which is probably the biggest evidence that these drugs work. So that is why I thought this should be brought out into the fora of dermatology. And that is why I thought I will bring back some of those old memories and how we are utilizing in our hospital. I was introduced to this particular set of dermatology armamentarium by Professor Sugathan. I joined him way back in 2014. And I was fresh out of college. I didn't know anything about Gallinicus, except I had seen some of my senior teachers using coal tar ointment for psoriasis and Castellani's paint by one or two senior teachers. And then subsequently, I had seen dilute potassium permanganate being used. But when I started associating with Professor Sugathan, that is when I realized that so much of is available in the Gallinicus preparations and the older preparations. So this, over the next 1 hour or nearly 45 minutes to an hour, what I wish to present before you is an overview of what all we have in our dispensing lab and how we are utilizing it in day-to-day practice. We have amalgamated this into the modern medicine treatment so that we are able to give patients effective outcomes. All of us know Sir James Hutchison, who is very famous for his quotations, which are taught from generation to generation. There was a letter to the editor written on the perils of modern treatment by Sir James Hutchison, in which he says, "I'm glad to see your correspondence about the abuse of modern remedies. And this needs to be recognized, but I think there should be a litany to be read in the hospital for doctors and nurses." And it reads like this, which we all know: from inability to let well alone, from too much zeal for the new and contempt for what is old, from putting knowledge before wisdom, science before art, and cleverness before common sense, from treating patients as cases, and from making the cure of the disease more grievous than the endurance of the same, good Lord, deliver us. The second line is what I am trying to impress upon here: too much zeal for the new and contempt for what is old. We should desist ourselves from having contempt for the old. All of us are running towards conferences to learn something new. So what's new in this talk? I am trying to chase not something new, but something old. You can call me retrograde or old school, but I believe that there is something in the old which we can always use in our current day practice. So I would rephrase that this title as what is old but relevant in practice. We all know that topicals are an essential prerequisite in dermatology, and probably dermatologists use the maximum amount of topicals. And the art and science of topical therapy is very basic learning to all the dermatologists. This presentation is totally non-pharma promoted. It's based on our individual experience. And I wish to reiterate that anecdotal medicine still has a role. And the beauty of our past legacy is time-tested. Now, strictly as per definition, Galenicals actually refer to medicinal preparations, which are derived from active constituents of a plant and made by a process that leaves the active material. The inert and undesirable constituents are actually removed, and only the active ingredient is brought in. That would be the strict definition of a Galenical. And to that, probably fits in podophyllin resin and diethanol. But more importantly, I'll be dealing with a lot more other drugs which were used earlier. So they were used a long time ago, about four decades ago, decades ago, and now they have lost to modern treatment. But they have certain advantages which I have noticed. There is greater flexibility and titration of the dose to suit the patient's needs. There's a tremendously reduced cost to the patient. The cost per prescription is hardly anything. And a lot of our patients are poor and they're not able to afford the huge amount of prescriptions which come out of the average modern day doctor, dermatologist. Faster recovery times is something which I have noted. And it is useful when other treatments have failed and they have a lesser adverse effect profile. But there are challenges to use of Galenicals in the modern day world. One, you need a dedicated dispensing and manufacturing support system. You need trained pharmacists. You need to source the drugs and raw material. And you need some amount of a long preparation time for each drug to be prepared and dispensed. As far as a physician is concerned, each new physician has to learn. So there's a learning curve in the usage of the drugs. And this dose titration is an art and must be learned by trial and error. And patient education sometimes takes some amount of time and effort. And that is probably very, very important when you're using any of these older preparations, because they can cause some amount of irritant dermatitis or staining. All these things should be told to these patients. Patients come back to us with concerns like they're messy, they're staining, they have irritancy potential. Some people read about carcinogenicity, and there is an anxiety about outdated technology. But all of these can be handled in a patient atmosphere. If we can give isotretinoin, which have so many side effects, we can explain. We can always explain about the difficulties one might face in Galenicals. I will focus on this particular aspect, the cost to the patient. The cost to the patient is extremely important, which we are not at all bothered about. Just imagine a patient with psoriasis comes to you in your outpatient. His travel and food expenses might range from 200 to 400. I'm talking about the Kerala scenario. My consultation fee would be around 300, plus a topical steroid, plus a moisturizer, plus an immunosuppressive. And if he cannot afford a biological, he just cannot afford. So you're talking about something like 800 to 2000 rupees. If I were to use a Galenical, I'm going to bring down the cost to something less than 200 rupees. And that would be the primary aim, to give, to deliver medical help wherever it is necessary with a very low cost. So welcome to the world of dispensing. The first and foremost thing which I would like to highlight, and probably the maximum number of units which are sold in our dispensing lab, is moisturizer. We have a moisturizer, what we call as hydrophilic ointment. This is from the British Pharmacopoeia, and it comprises of sodium lauryl sulfate, methyl paraben, propyl paraben, and of course, propylene glycol. There's much said about propylene glycol and SS, but having said that, far and few between only do we find reactions to propylene glycol. Patients' acceptability is very good, and each jar of hydrophilic ointment would not cost the patient more than 120 rupees for about 100 gram, whereas a 100 gram moisturizer would cost anywhere from 250 to 300 rupees in the commercial market. So there are variations of the hydrophilic ointment which we have. Like, we add urea in hydrophilic ointment, which is very effective in ichthyosis vulgaris. Patients need these refills of moisturizer. So we add urea, and this is patients are extremely happy with the preparations which we give. If we need very thick hyperkeratotic lesions, which we are dealing with, we can add a little bit of salicylic acid, which will actually make it a much more acceptable preparation. Liquid paraffin, white vaseline, and white soft paraffin are readily available in our dispensing pharmacy, which makes it easy to dispense any medication and use this as a vehicle. And this is how the hydrophilic ointment would look once the preparation is made in the lab. And that is sold as finally units. In fact, there are so many patients who come regularly on a regular basis, those who have ichthyosis, those who have renal pruritus, those who have senile esteatotic dermatitis, they all flock to us asking for this particular elegant preparation, which we have. The second group is antipruritics. So calamine is a well-known antipruritic. All of us have been using it. And there are several variants of calamine which we use. We call this mentholated calamine lotion. To calamine, we add menthol and camphor. And when it is given in calamine lotion, in the strength which I have shown here, this is menthol 0.5 gram, camphor 5 gram, and calamine lotion 500 ml. It's an excellent antipruritic agent. Similarly, if you feel that the patient has a very dry skin and you're not, calamine is not being tolerated, you can always use linimentum calamine, which contains a slight amount of an oily base, which makes it easier for the patient acceptability as well as the dryness is prevented and the pruritus is well taken care of. The third is to add phenol, a small amount of phenol, which will also act as an antipruritic and will be quite effective. The next agent which I would like to introduce is Castellani's paint and gentian violet. Hardly anybody uses this now, but this is where actually I started getting convinced about Gallinicus. I was thrown a challenge by Professor Subudhan once when we had a patient in the ICU, and this patient had a bed sore with an intertrigo of the groin. And sir, I was accompanying sir on rounds, and then I said, he asked me, what will you give? Then I said, I'll give an antifungal, oral antifungal, fluconazole, 150 milligram once a week for 4 weeks, and I'll also give a probably a dactarin gel, and I'll give a powder of a clotrimazole. He said, you do yours, I will do mine. We did it on a split basis, on one side each. He used Castellani's paint, and I used my set of medications topically. I didn't use any oral at all. And surprisingly enough, within 7 days, that side had become dry. It was oozy, it was wet, and that had become completely dry. And I was convinced that Castellani's paint can actually be effective in 5 to 7 days' time. So Castellani's paint was first identified, developed by Aldo Castellani, an Italian physician, who was a specialist in tropical diseases. This is a composition of Castellani's paint. It contains basifusion, which is usually used as stain in histopathology and in microbiology. But it also has a bactericidal, fungicidal, local anesthetic, and it also stimulates granulation tissue and epithelialization. Ethyl alcohol is a base, it's a vehicle, and it's also an antiseptic, which is very effective where it, to prevent a secondary fungal infection. Boric acid is an antiseptic, and even phenol, liquefied phenol, and acetone and resorcinol there, and especially resorcinol is an antipruritic and a keratolytic. So water is added to it to make it up to 100 ml. This is the composition of Castellani's paint. This is a classic presentation where I would use a Castellani's paint. This is very often dealt with loads of antifungal creams and systemic antifungals. And most patients would present with a recurrent problem, itching on removing the undergarments with foul smell, and it also affects their sexual confidence. So my approach would be to look for lifestyle issues. Are they seated for long? Like for example, a student, or they are at counters in offices, or are they traders? Are they using polyester blended fabric? Especially women lately have started presenting a lot with intertrigo lesions. Do they travel in bikes, or do they have cycling? Do they involve themselves in workouts and exercise? Are they wearing tight dresses? Obesity and metabolic syndrome, which is off late, very, very common, and of course, diabetes, all of these are precipitating. Having done that workup, then I would probably give other advice like use of soft cotton undergarments, loose clothing, and identify the cleansing and occupation hobbies. Sometimes I wedge with cotton pads when it is very oozy, and I also advise this sort of undergarments. So which would actually allow breathability, and at the same time, this would also prevent the oozing and maceration because of the piping of the V-shaped undergarments. Now, this is the most effective thing which I use. I prescribe around 7 days, 5 to 7 days of Castellani's paint. The staining is a major drawback in this. But patients, once they use it, they say, but for the stain, I'm okay with the stain, but the itching is gone, the oozing is gone, the skin re-epithelizes very well. You can notice a difference that can be appreciated in hardly about a week. Now, there are other indications for which I use Castellani's paint. One would be perianal dermatitis, especially in children, scrotal dermatitis, then tinea pedis of the intertriginous variant. And of course, macerated foot, especially in those patients with obsessive compulsive disorders who have, very often they have to go to the bathroom, elderly people. or maybe farmers who may be working in wet lands. Or you can also use it in flexural candidiasis, inframammary areas in most women, or even a diaper dermatitis like these. And excellent results in hardly about a week to 10 days is excellent for as far as we are concerned. The cost of therapy is per ml, it's just 1 rupee. It means 15 ml costs 15 rupees. 15 ml is sufficient for a week. Maximum, if it is a person is very obese and large surface area, we might go in for 30 ml, which is 30 rupees. It's hardly anything which the patient cannot afford. Now, the color is a major concern and it can stain the fingers and the undergarments. And it's a little messy to apply. So we educate them to use a glove and use a cotton bud as an applicator. But the results definitely outweigh the difficulties. Now, colorless castanets paint has been tried, but it's not come into the market. And it was very difficult to obtain this. There's hardly anything available on Amazon, which I look for. What is the difference between colorless and this? The basic product there is basic fusion in classical castanets paint. But in this, we do not have basic fusion and therefore it becomes colorless. But having said that, the basic fusion has a very is an important ingredient. And that is why the efficacy is also much better with the basic fusion. If one wants to know a little more about castanets paint, there's an excellent article written by Dr. Manish Kesha from Mumbai in our own journal, the IJDDL. So I think it's worthwhile reading this about castanets paint. The second paint group, which I would advise is gentian violet. It was first synthesized by Charles Loth, and it was actually Hans Gram of Gram Stain famous, fame, who actually used this. And he identified gram-positive bacteria using this. But incidentally, it was Church who actually said that the antibacterial action against gram-positive bacteria is also important, relevant here. So there are practitioners who would use this, especially in methicillin-resistant staph aureus, MRSA, which is quite common these days. And very often, tons of oral antibiotics are given again and again and again. Including high-end antibiotics like linezolid or vancomycin. I think cutaneous manifestations of MRSA, when we get pus culture sensitivity showing MRSA, one can actually try gentian violet because it's quite effective against gram-positive bacteria. You can even use it in Pseudomonas infection and Candida. And probably we are using it a lot more in dermatitis cutis pustulosa atrophicus on the legs and on the forearms when the pustular stages. So if you would like to read a little more about gentian violet, that's also available on our IJDBL, the residence page. And the next and the trump card for the current generation, I think, would be Whitfield's ointment. Everybody's afraid to use Whitfield ointment because of the irritancy potential. I think I will educate you all a little bit about how it is to be used and how effectively it can be managed if you use it judiciously. This is a dreadful reality which we are all facing. The resistant dermatophyte infections. And a lot of higher antifungals are being misused, especially the misuse of itraconazole. And to top it, people have started using voriconazole and they're getting fed up with topicals not working. And that is when probably we have to relook at our age-old Whitfield. Now, this is the usual presentation which we see of Tinea corporis, resistant Tinea versicolor of varying forms and presentations. Now, this is a variant of Tinea versicolor which we see on and off, especially those with metabolic syndrome where they have very thick adherent scales. So such patients actually, we wish that we had a salicylic acid which would actually also induce a keratolysis. Now here, a small dose of Whitfield ointment actually does wonders and it limits the use of fluconazole or an itraconazole. So Whitfield is actually a very good alternative topical agent. This is named after Arthur Whitfield, a British dermatologist. This, I would say, has undergone a rebirth akin to thalidomide. And this is how it looks. It's almost like a white vaseline-like look, a slightly yellowish tinge is there. But the composition is the classical Whitfield, which was earlier described by Arthur, was 3 grams of salicylic acid with benzoic acid 6 grams and vaseline 100 grams. But we have modified it. Make it about 6 grams of salicylic acid with 6 grams of benzoic acid and vaseline 100 grams. Now, we have variants of this. We use just the plain Whitfield ointment, which I described, but we also add tar into it, Whitfield et tar, we call it, where we add Lycopisces carbonus 7 ml. And sometimes we use it in the form of a tincture where ethanol is the base. So ethanol gives a much greater spreadability. Whereas if we're using Whitfield Ektar ointment, especially on the trunk lesions or on the non-intertriginous areas, this would be quite effective. Because coal tar itself has an antimitotic action, as well as it also has an fungicidal action. So when to use Whitfield is something which all postgraduates should know. You should use Whitfields only when lesions are dry, like the one I have shown here, or if there is no ooze, or if there is no erythema and there is no burning. This is the basic morphologic type where you can safely use Whitfield. Everybody is worried about irritant dermatitis. It's largely because the mode of application is explained wrongly to the patient. It's your duty when you prescribe a medicine to explain to the patient how to use it. So what we do is we have a jar of Whitfield ointment kept by the side. We show them, demonstrate them that you're going to take a small mustard seed amount, apply it on the margin of the lesion where the maximum activity is, and then spread it very slowly into the inside of the lesion too. So when very small quantities are applied, they tolerate it very well. And we tell them that some amount of burning can be expected, but if it is burning excessively, wash it off or wipe it off with coconut oil or an emollient, and that would serve the purpose. So the irritancy potential of Whitfield is prevented if you explain to the patient how it is to be applied. But the efficacy is really good. If you have a case of tenia versiculata which is not responding to the usual lines of treatment, you can still try Whitfield. This is a result which was seen in just 3 weeks of using Whitfield, and hardly any oral antifungal we have used. Now, there was a formal study done by a pharmacologist by name Thakkar, who I actually was able to identify that around 80.77% of patients were completely cleared of the lesion within the second follow-up, just 20 days, and 98.08% were completely cleared at third follow-up, that is 30 days. So this is the only study which is there on Whitfields. Probably there is a scope for studying Whitfield. Because many people in the pharma industry and doctors have been talking about adding salicylic acid to the routine antifungals as a combination, just like we have a steroid salicylic and antifungal with a salicylic acid. I would suggest that something on these lines should be studied in the medical colleges, and a trial can be conducted, and probably we can have more papers related to that. Now, when not to use Whitfield, that's absolutely essential. That clinical judgment is what decides it all. If the lesions are inflamed and angry, do not use Whitfields. If it is oozing, do not use. If it is burning, do not use. And if they are pustular eruptions, do not use Whitfields. A lesion like this, never use Whitfields. Or a lesion like this also, never use Whitfield. Here, a Castellani's paint would be a much better thing. Or allow, just apply saline compresses for about 3 days to 4 days, and then apply Castellani's paint, and you get much better results. So only when the lesions have completely become dry can you think even about using Whitfield's ointment. We don't generally recommend Whitfield's in children and on the face, because the irritancy potential may be much higher because the epidermal barrier is very thin. Now, coming to salicylic acid preparations and its variants. Salicylic acid is a versatile agent. You can use it in different concentrations, ranging from 3 grams, which is a keratoplastic action, to a 17 grams to 20 grams, where you need a short contact and a very thick hyperkeratotic lesion. So you have a range of salicylic acid which can be used. It's a very, very useful accompaniment in your dispensing pharmacy. And you use it in almost in every other agent which we use in, whether it be an anti-acne preparation or even for that matter, the keratotic lesions like this, the hyperkeratotic lesion on the sole. What we have tweaked here is we use salicylic acid like this. For example, most commercial preparations would be available as 6, 12, 17, and 30. You have a fixed concentration. What if you want something in between? So we can use about 14 grams of salicylic acid, to which benzoic acid 6 grams is added, and then Vaseline is added 100 grams. This is triturated and then dispensed as a jar. So for fissured feet, it works very well. This concentration of salicylic acid works very well. You can always increase it. If you find that the fissuring is more, or if you find it a very thick hyperkeratotic lesions, you can increase it. Or you can have a case of plantar psoriasis. You can increase up to 16 grams, and you can add a little bit of coal tar. Which topical agent in the commercial market can you actually titrate like this, depending upon the individual's need? Because everything is available as a 6% salicylic acid or a 3% salicylic acid. Nobody gives you 10% salicylic. So invariably, you end up adding as topical steroid with another salicylic acid ointment. So this Gallinicus or this particular set of dispensing pharmacy actually gives you that flexibility. That is the biggest USP as far as I am concerned, that we are able to manage cases in such a way. Tricoffite and Rubra, we put tons of antifungals onto the patient's foot. But I think by far the best results and the fastest results we have got is with the Whitfield's, modified Whitfield's. So we can vary the concentration of salicylic acid depending upon how much we need. Now, coming to coal tar and dithranol, this is something which has been used for a very long time. It's proven that coal tar is one of the best agents as far as psoriasis is concerned as an antimitotic agent, and dithranol is even better. You have the Gokerman regimen and everything being taught during a postgraduate, but none of us use it. So once we start using coal tar and you know how to blend it and how to sort of titrate it to individualize the dose, then it becomes easy. And patients come back to you. I'll show you two clinical examples where our patients were able to do well. When it comes to psoriasis, we have these options with us as far as dispensing pharmacy is concerned. We give coal tar ointment containing either a Lycopyscis carbonis or a liquefied form of coal tar, or we can use a unguentum Pisces carbonis, which is a solidified one, and they're usually based in Vaseline. Or you can use it as a coal tar solution where the coal tar is added to ethanol. And then finally, you have a dithranol-based preparations where you can use it either with LPC, with UPC, or you can use it as ethanol-based, especially in nail psoriasis. You can use it as a to be dropped underneath the nail. So it contains salicylic acid, it contains coal tar, and it will be quite effective as an antimitotic. Now, this is how our prescription would be. It will contain 0.1 gram of salicylic acid. We start with 0.1 gram of dithranol, and we can go slowly. Every visit, the patient's dithranol is increased, depending on how well he tolerates. So, and even the salicylic acid can be titrated, whether you want 5 gram, 7 gram, whatever you feel is comfortable. Lycopyscis carbon is also similar. So our prescription would be something like, we start off a prescription, something like this. So if you want to add UPC instead of LPC, then you can always add that, and then that variant is also taken care of. Now, this is quite effective, in fact, in scalp psoriasis, where we are finding thick lesions, adherent lesions. So the dictum is that do not use ointment base in hairy area. However, when this is used in very small quantities on thick hyperkeratotic areas, we find that it is quite effective. If the patients are taught how to apply, they would apply it very, very well, and they get excellent results. And they are happy to come back to get this particular jar of coal tar ointment because the efficacy of coal tar is there for them to see. We don't have any of the side effects of topical steroid overusage. After a certain point in time, topical steroids fail to work. You can also use it on a seesaw basis where you can use a topical steroid for some time to gain control over a lesion at a particular point in time and then move over to coal tar so that both are not used in excess quantities. This is the case of a childhood psoriasis, which I am giving you as an example. This patient actually first visited us on the 3rd of November in 2014. So he had already been treated by several dermatologists and he had come to Professor Subodhan for an opinion. He had already been on methotrexate, antibiotics, and systemic steroids and topical agents. Cyclosporin was being planned. So they were from a far-off hilly area on the bordering Kerala and Tamil Nadu called the Nilgiris. So they had traveled something around 5 hours just to meet Professor Subodhan. So he actually, the first thing that we do whenever a patient comes with an acutely inflamed psoriatic lesion is to prescribe just calamine lotion. So we give a prescription of mentholated calamine lotion, menthol camphor, and linimentum calamine. This is where I said linimentum because skin lesions are dry. So we can use a little bit of an oily base. So linimentum calamine will work. Then Rulide is actually azithromycin, a small dose. Testilora is loratadine, and Episoft, as you all know, is a cleanser. So that is what was prescribed initially to allow the lesions to settle down. So the next visit, Professor Sudhan had left by the afternoon, and this patient actually came to me in the afternoon. And this was the presentation November of 2014. So you just have a picture of how the patient is actually presented. Now, on the 8th of November, that's about 3-4 days after he had come, I started prescribing coal tar ointment, which comprised of salicylic acid 4 gram, UPC 4 gram, and Vaseline, a small dose of Humazone, clobetasone for the face, and I gave a Phenergan because he had intense itch, and Moisan is actually a liquid paraffin, a commercial preparation of a liquid paraffin. Now, what happens after this? Patient comes back on the 22nd, and then between 8th and 22nd is roughly around 2 weeks. Patient has significantly improved, you can see. And the lesions have settled down. And this is the time when you can actually fluctuate between the body, the scalp, and the face. So this is the beauty, again, flexibility using gadgets. So body, we gave 4 and 4 gram. For the scalp, we gave 4 and 5 gram because it required a higher concentration. And for the face, we gave just 3 and 3 gram. And he needed 200 grams of each because he was coming from far away. He was supposed to come only about a month later. And the rest of the prescriptions are maintained as such. Now, this is what we got in December. So which means that within a span of about 6 weeks, we are able to achieve a clearance like this. The same thing which we get in biologic, which is the same thing we get in probably cyclosporin. But the remission periods here is much, much longer. This is what has been my personal experience. The remission period between two attacks is much, much longer. And these patients actually spend nearly 1/100th of what they would be spending on an immunosuppressant. So our dictum is, if possible, avoid an immunosuppressant. But if it is necessary to, for an acute crisis, probably you would be using. At least that's my personal take on. But as far as possible, with this itself, we can actually titrate it and bring it to its normal state. And he was so happy at the end of it, he could go to school and his friends were keeping him away and he was able to manage with just simple medication. They were from a very poor family and I was able to help them out. And that satisfaction is equivalent to a large sum of money in my bank. So this is the final prescription. We just sent him with mentholated Lamentum calaminate as for the post-inflammatory pigmentation. Now this is another girl who actually came as recently as last year on the 19th of August. And she was admitted, put in, and we just gave her simple medications. And by the 7th of September, she had an excellent response. She was around a 23-year-old girl who actually was to be married. And she's now happily married and she just invited me for her wedding. And this is simple prescriptions of coal tar ointment with a little bit of iron and liquid paraffin. Hardly much we have done actively to harm the patient's liver or harm the patient's blood values. Dithranol is something which we add when we feel that the coal tar needs a little bit of a more support, sort of, because dithranol is a lot more staining and it's darker in color. Patient's acceptability is a little lesser, so we add dithranol in small doses, but it is way much more effective than plain coal tar. Now, this is how dithranol looks as a yellow powder. We need in our dispensing lab an electronic balance like this. So we are taking about 0.1 grams of dithranol, which was our concentration. The pharmacist will look at our prescription and take about 0.1. And to that, salicylic acid, about 5 grams. This is salicylic acid. And then this salicylic acid is mixed with dithranol and triturated like this. That's done by the... We have some good trained pharmacists, to which a small amount of olive oil is added so that it can be easily mixed. Notice the action, notice the amount of effort which is involved, but it has to come out as a very smooth, very, very uniform preparation. No lumps, absolutely no grains should be there. And that is how it is done. So if trained well, these people know how to do it. And then we take about 5 grams of salicylic acid, which was the prescription which we had decided upon. And then we add Vaseline to that. So when we write a prescription, we say make up to 100 gram or make up to 100 ml. So whatever we have used as salicylic acid and whatever we used as dithranol, all of this is subtracted from 100 and then we add that much of Vaseline. And this is finally added on like this and made into a paste, and which is then dispensed in a jar. And that is what is applied by the patient on these psoriatic lesions. So the final product will be dispensed in this form. So this is what is happening in our dispensing lab. So I just want to show you a glimpse of what exactly happens in the dispensing lab. So the other agent which I would like to focus upon is sulfur ointment or special sulfur ointment. This is a very common problem which we encounter in clinical practice. We call it rosacea, we call it demodicidosis. Demodex has been implicated in rosacea. most of us would be using something like a doxycycline or a tetracycline group of drugs, or we use permethrin, or we use metronidazole. These are various drugs which have been used. But apart from this, we add a little spironolactone, and I'll be able to show you the results of how it works. These are the varying presentations of demodicidosis. So first, when a patient comes to us with demodicidosis, so the first thing which we do is to test for the demodex folliculorum. Now that is done by what is known as a superficial skin biopsy. A superficial skin biopsy, we use one anesthetic ether to degrease the area, remove all the sebum. And these are the essential ingredients which are required. We need an artery forceps, we need super glue, we need anesthetic ether, acetone, cedarwood oil, cover slips, and glass slides and cotton balls. So first, anesthetic ether is used to degrease that area. And then a small amount of super glue is added onto the glass slide. And these glass slides, they are placed on the cheeks where the demodex is, so that it sticks onto that. And then slowly that is eased out using the artery forceps. Very, very gently that is eased out. And you have the small amount of the skin which is stuck onto the glass slide. And to that small amount of cedarwood oil, one drop of cedarwood oil is added. A cover slip is placed on that. And this video will show you the demodex. You can see the worm, the mite actually moving its limbs. This is a grab video which you can see of that demodex mite. So once we identify demodex mite, especially the density of the demodex mite, just one single demodex mite or two is not sufficient to that florid, but it usually correlates with the amount of lesions that you see. Florid lesions, you will see more of demodicidosis. So these are the drugs which are usually commonly used, but this unmet need for therapy has been rectified with 25% sulfur ointment in Vaseline base. So this sulfur powder is called precipitated sulfur. And to that, white Vaseline is added. So 2.5 grams of precipitated sulfur is ground to remove any lumps, mixed with olive oil, added drop by drop. And to it, we add Vaseline. And if we need large quantities, we take 25 grams and 100 grams of Vaseline. So this is actually triturated like this. So that's the sulfur powder, which is ground to remove any lumps. To that is added a small amount of olive oil to ease the way that we grind it. And then Vaseline is added, and then the whole thing is mixed. It's a simple process, but it requires a little bit of painstaking effort on the part of the pharmacist to actually make this. Once you've trained them to make it, they make in large loads, which we are able to honor our patients' prescriptions very easy. So this is the final preparation which is used. But having said that, this final preparation cannot be applied in its entirety. Again, we explain to them how it is to be used. We ask them to bring back the medication. And the medication, a small amount is taken on the fingertip. It is just rolled between the fingertips, starting from the base of the nose up to the cheeks. That is where the maximum is. Also ask them to apply above the eyebrows and the forehead, where again, demodex is quite common, and apply it on the chin. So this movement is what is important here, right? So we are using very small quantities at the fingertips. And this is the lesion which you saw, the lady which you saw earlier with the straps on. This is after treatment. And you can also see before and after in this area with sulfur ointment, treated with 40%. 40% sulfur is quite strong. It's an irritant. So patients might come back to you saying that they have a swelling or they have a redness. So tell them to report immediately if they have redness. So that way your rapport with the patient is very good. You have forewarned them. Ask them to stop the medication and immediately wash it off or use a little bit of ice compresses. And probably over the telephone, you can give a topical corticosteroid for about 2 days or 3 days. That will help the irritant dermatitis to subside. So this is a very, very effective method that we have identified. Is there evidence for this? We were able to identify that sulfur for rosacea is coming back in the JAD journal, I was able to pick up this article. It's something which was there for a very long time. It's quite commonly used in China. That's what I could read from the literature. So this next one is a vintage magic cure. So this was actually a 9-year-old girl who had presented to us with weight loss, and she had lethargy. She had recurrent scaly lesions on the scalp, and it was on down the limbs, and they were itchy. She was treated as psoriasis multiple times. I was put through the quiz as to what my diagnosis was, and as a novice at that point in time, I had not seen a lesion like this, so I too said it was psoriasis. And Professor Sugathan said, look again. And this was a lesion on the ear. And this lesion clicked the diagnosis for me. I said, probably we are dealing with crusted scabies, because this sort of hyperkeratotic, but haven't seen such crusted scabies, really bad crusted scabies. So this patient was sent by a pediatrician to us. And already patient had been on several treatments, including topical steroids and salicylic acid, antihistamines, immunosuppressives even were given, thinking it was psoriasis. Now, when the patient was diagnosed, we thought we would have a proper diagnosis. So we were waiting for a skin biopsy, and we were able to identify the mites in this. So it was a case of crusted scabies. And we treated with permethrin and ivermectin and benzoyl-benzoate. Absolutely, it didn't change at all. The lesions remained as they were. So that is when Professor decided to come up with something which he had learned during his younger days. There is something called unguentum hydrogenatum ammoniacum dilutum. It's a mercury compound that can be added to salicylic acid and lycopolysis carbonis and purified white plastin as a base. So this galenical preparation, we got it dispensed in our pharmacy, and voila, we had a wonderful response coming in. So we thought we should publish this, and that is how we put it on our IJD, Indian Journal of Dermatology, and we published this as galenicals in the treatment of crusted scabies. In fact, this was the first paper of mine gifted to me by Professor Sugathan, and that started my journey of writing up a little bit, whatever little I have done. Now, there are preparations even for acne. Now, this is what we call as sulfur salicylic lotion. That is, it contains salicylic acid, prespirate sulfur, and calamine lotion as a base. So this is the usual starting concentration of around 4 gram to 5 gram. Now, if you ask a patient to apply a pack, she will do it. If you ask a patient to undergo a salicylic acid peel, they will undergo it. So if it's sulfur salicylic, why not? So this looks like something like a pack, because when it is applied and gently scrubbed on, it looked like a small amount of pack. I applied on the dorsum of the hand to show how the patient would look. But they're asked to do it at the end of the day before retiring to bed, apply. This acts as a beautiful keratolytic, especially in the microcomedonal as well as the grade 1 and grade 2 comedonal lesions. Excellent response. Even in truncal acne, imagine giving a topical benzoyl peroxide or a retinoid on the back. Extensive lesions. If you have a lotion, it is so much easier to apply it on the back. The spreadability is more, large surface area is covered. That unmet need is actually taken care of by this particular agent, which is sulfur salicylic lotion. So we can actually titrate the dose for the face as well as the back. So when a patient comes, we usually write a prescription, one for the face and one for the back. So the salicylic acid will be slightly higher. The prescribed sulfur can be titrated. Next time when the patient comes, you feel the response is inadequate. The patient is still complaining of oiliness, especially those patients who come with oily faces. This is excellent because sulfur is a very good drying and a desiccating agent, and salicylic acid is a keratolytic agent. The only thing which you have to be aware of when you're giving both a salicylic acid with sulfur and a oil-reducing face wash, it can cause an irritant. And if you add a retinoid to that, it can cause more irritants. So this is something as a judgment we should have when not to give a retinoid at this point in time. So this should be the initial a prescription in those patients who have grade 1 and grade 2 acne. Even up to grade 3, I would go. When once we do a comedo extraction, then we can actually clear the pustules or the comedones, and then we can give this, and this gives excellent response. It can also be used, in fact, in post-inflammatory pigmentation of acne. So that's the beauty of this. The only thing is they have to be regimented about applying this, and some people do find it difficult because it's messy, but those who are really suffering from bad acne and they know that they are coming here for an agent which is different from, and it's very cheap. This is 100 and something. That's it, 100 odd rupees. That's what we sell it for. And the amount of money which is spent on anti-acne medications is enormous. The peels cost even more. I do peels, but when I add a peel along with this, it works tremendously well. Once the lesions are completely controlled, the comedones are controlled, and then we go in for a peel or aesthetic procedures, it works really well. So this is how the preparation looks. So what I was referring to is that titratability, where you can actually increase or decrease the salicylic acid or the sulfur depending upon the, and quite effective in truncal acne and drug-induced acneiform eruptions. Now, there are preparations also for paronychia. Like, we use absolute alcohol or ethanol. To procure ethanol or absolute alcohol is not that easy because there's a lot of licensing. Unfortunately, or strangely enough, homeopathic medications contain a lot of ethanol, but they are given so easily, so liberally. But we as practitioners, we find it difficult to get ethanol. So we have to go through special licensing mechanisms to get it onto a dispensing lab to prepare our preparations because it requires absolute alcohol or 95% ethanol. That is a process which has been supported well by our management. That is why we find it easy to procure this and then use it in our dispensing lab. Surgical spirit is an alternative isopropyl alcohol, but not definitely doesn't come as close to ethanol. Thymol in chloroform is something which the seniors may have used, 1 ml in 25 ml of ethanol. So that is something which can also be tried in, and as well as Castani's paint, which I mentioned, that can be used in chronic paronychia patients also. We have dandruff preparations, which comprise of salicylic acid, resorcinol, lycopices, and ethanol, which is quite effective in those patients who have very dry dandruff or the Sitka variety of dandruff. This is something which I learned after my post-graduation, starch and boric poultice. Hardly anybody knows who is coming out of postgraduate course these days. When you get a patient with a tinea amentacea, this is one of the best agents which you can use to actually remove off the crust. And those patients who come with pediculosis with maggots, or those patients who come with thick crusted lesions, even on the leg ulcers, or those areas which are really badly oozy, macerated, and thick and crusts are there, plica polonica, all those such areas you can actually use this. This comprises of starch powder, 1 tablespoon, with 1 heaped teaspoon of boric acid. The two are mixed with a little bit of cold water to make a paste, and then 1/2 cup of boiling water is added. So once you add the boiling water, you get a thick paste like this. So this well-gelled paste is actually placed on a clean laundered cloth. And then at tolerable heat, this whole cloth with the material is actually placed just like a turban pua. It's actually placed on the scalp. Leave it for about 15 to 20 minutes or even up to, about 2 hours. And the entire thing, when you remove it, the crusts come along with that because it melts the crusts literally. So the crusts come off along with that. And you can actually, edge of the cloth can be sealed with Vaseline or olive oil so that it doesn't fall off. This is an interesting article by Montgomery, Douglas Montgomery, which was published in JAMA, which I was able to procure. And when you go through that, it is wonderful to see how they actually did the good old-fashioned poultice. This is quite effective even now. I have tried in several patients, and Professor Sudhan has actually taught me to do this. And I'm very grateful that we are able to have such wonderful gems in our armamentarium. Zinc oxide-based preparations, I think quite a number of you all know about it. Zinc oxide can be used in insect bite reactions on the legs especially, and in Schamburg's purpura. So there is something which we use as zinc cream. Lasers paste in diaper dermatitis, burns, cuts, wounds, and as a barrier against irritants. And it actually moisturizes well. This is something which has been tried. And hair tincture for alopecia. This is a hair stimulant, which we use boric acid, resorcinol, phenol, and a little bit of castroid. So that actually acts as a stimulant. So a bottle of minoxidil will cost anywhere from 400 to 900 to the patient, but this hardly, we are selling it for less than 150 rupees. Solutions. Condi solution is something which all of us have learned during our PG days. We continue to use it, especially freshly prepared. We have to explain to the patient it should be freshly prepared. It should not be used beyond 24 hours. You have to explain to the patient that it should be diluted, and you have to demonstrate to the patient how the dilution is to be done. And then your patient is very, very happy. And ask them to use it for about a day or two and then move on to saline compressors. So the pus and the muck is all removed from the wounds. gargles are effective for Steven Johnson syndrome patients, poor oral hygiene patients, necrotizing gingivitis, herpetic ulcers, and after patients come with really painful, one or two gargles with potassium permanganate is quite effective. Compresses, we all know, we use it for infected eczema patients, diabetic patients, or necrotizing infections. Soaks for infected eczema we use. I think most of you all know about Condi's compresses. But it's good to have a bowl with you in the in your OP and demonstrate as to how it is to be done. So what I do is I have grains of potassium permanganate. I put it and then show that the blue color occurs first. This is your stock solution. And then you add it to a larger amount of water and then you get this color. So this color remains in the mind of an average villager or an average patient. Nothing like visual explanation. And this is quite effective to give it to these patients. There are other solutions like the Burrow solutions, which not very often we use, normal saline. Usol solution, my surgeon in my hospital is around 30 years he's been working. He still believes in Usol solution for diabetic foot ulcers. And it contains actually 1.25 grams of boric acid with bleaching powder and sterile water up to 100 ml. It's quite effective actually because it releases nascent chlorine from the bleaching powder and it separates the slough from the infected wounds, the ulcers, the bed sores, neglected patients. And incidentally, it's very effective because it does not allow Pseudomonas to grow because it contains an acidic pH. So that's the beauty of this preparation. We use something called silver nitrate in solitary aphthae. So when aphthae occurs, it is because of an end artery occlusion of the blood vessels. So there's a coagulopathy occurring there. So when we apply the silver nitrate in ethanol with a small toothpick, the blunt end of the toothpick is just placed onto the aphthae, that will coagulate the protein there and virtually instantly the pain is numbed. So that way, a patient who comes with a very severe painful aphthae, we have taken care of. So patient is advised how to apply it. So the coagulation actually is like closing the nerve ending. You're preparing a coagulated tissue which will block the nerve endings and thereby the pain is completely lost. It is when the person respires, person takes food, it goes and touches the nerve endings, that is why the pain occurs. And that is taken care of by this. Even yesterday, day before yesterday, I had this wonderful response to acetic acid. Surgeon's mother actually came with a profound irritant dermatitis and degloved the entire superficial layer of the epidermis of the palm because she has handled a caustic substance. And it had gone in for a Pseudomonas infection. And he was amazed at the way acetic acid works. 1% acetic acid. So it's good and handy to keep glacial acetic acid in your outpatient and train your nurses to prepare the 1% acetic acid compressed. So that can be poured onto the wound, even for diabetic foot or Pseudomonas infections, even in nail Pseudomonas, you can always use a small amount of acetic acid. But care should be taken, that should be dispensed by you and it should be handled by you because it can go really bad if you do not handle it yourself. This is another tip which I was able to gain about sodium bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate is available as a commercial chemical in the lab chemical, but you can always ask if a patient cannot buy a lab chemical, you can always ask them to use the baking soda. So sodium bicarbonate we use for crusted lesions and we also use to break the thick nails. When there is onychogryphosis and the nails are very thick and difficult to cut, you can actually soak the soda bicarb solution, cotton cloth, or the patient can dip the foot with the nails in the soda bicarb solution. That softens the nails, it becomes easy to cut. So we usually prescribe around 2% or 4% solution. So it's also essential that you know how to prepare a 4% or 2% solution. 2% means 2 in 100 ml, which means 20 grams in 1000 ml. So 4 teaspoons in 1 liter of water would make it a 2% solution. So that 2% solution is what the patient dips the leg in and the crusted lesions can well be removed with that if a compress is given or the thickened nails can easily be cut. You can also increase the concentration. If 4%, you can even go up to 6 to 8% when their nails are very thick. I have tried that. This is something which we still use in our pharmacy, podophyllin, 25% podophyllin tincture benzoin for patients presenting with their genital warts. Sporotrichosis, this is it was asked very often during our post-graduation examinations how to use potassium iodide for sporotrichosis. It's quite an effective treatment, but not for systematized cases only for cutaneous presentations. So usually it requires 20 grams and 13 ml to be prepared, make up to 20 ml, and then start the patient with 3 drops TID. And then next day the patient takes 4 drops. So he keeps on increasing drop by drop. You can go up to 40 drops TID. Or until the features of iodism, like person starts developing salivation, rhinorrhea, lacrimation, or tinnitus, then it means that you've reached the upper limit. So either 40 drops TID or the signs of iodism. But we have always got to assess for hypothyroidism because it can inhibit the thyroid synthesis because it is an iodine base. This is something which can be tried in resistant cases of sporotrichosis when it is not working. There are several therapies for molluscum also. Like you can use tincture iodine, you can use silver nitrate, you can use phenol, TCA, podophyllin, 10% KOH. These are all agents which were used earlier. And even now review articles will tell you, this is a review article as late as 1994. You have those age-old methods still being used and found effective. So depending upon one's comfort, one can actually use these age-old therapies. This is another tip about tincture benzoin. Tincture benzoin is something which is available as compound tincture benzoin. We are using it for two indications. One, after we do a scalp biopsy, it is very difficult to put a plaster on top of it because the hair comes in between. When you remove the plaster, the hair is also removed. A very simple and effective method is to actually take a very thin layer of cotton, apply the tincture benzoin on top of it. Can you see this here? This is the tincture benzoin applied on top of it. It stays there and it sticks there. So it's easy for you to actually place this as a dressing. The cotton wisp stands there. It doesn't come off. And at the same time, you need not use any plastering material. So this is what I want to show on the dorsum of the hand as to how it sticks on. Otherwise, this cotton would have flown off by the time I took a photograph. Right? This is something which we have found. And even biopsy of bullous lesions, because the Nikolsky sign will be positive in pemphigus. So if after biopsy you don't want to irritate the skin, you can always use a little bit of tincture benzoin. This will act effectively. It also has an antibacterial action, by the way. We also use it for lip colitis. Apply a little bit of tincture benzoin on the lip, and this acts as a barrier, a membrane barrier, which will prevent the child from licking again and again. You can also use it in perioral dermatitis, where it acts as a barrier and prevents the dermatitis from arising further. Now, having shown you an overview of all this, it's important to know how to set up a dispensing pharmacy. If in due course you would like to, after seeing this presentation, or if you would like, are interested in doing that, we thought I'll just run you through how we have to do it. Any dispensing lab requires a very, very motivated pharmacist. So training the pharmacist is very, very important. Sir has been in our dispensing pharmacy in our hospital for about 1992 to here. So roughly around 28 years he has been with this hospital, and he started dispensing lab, our own dispensing lab. And this gentleman by name Mr. Roy is his right hand, our right hand, so to say, our go-to man for everything. He has literally been handed over all the information about how to dispense. So including the availability of raw materials has been taken care of by processors. So it's an enduring partnership which has been going on for over 30 years. We need certain raw materials. We will need an electrolytic balance. You'll need a mortar and pestle. You'll need a mixie, a gentle mixie, which will actually help to mix up. And you need a manual. Actually, you have to give them a manual as to how it is to be prepared. And the raw materials need to be procured on time, every time. We need a water bath, because something like hydrophilic ointment, which I mentioned, require water bath. This is how hydrophilic ointment in the water bath looks immediately after it is prepared. And we need to source all these chemicals. So we need to have a list of chemicals which we need, and we need to source them from the appropriate. Say, for example, salicylic acid, diethanol, we used to get it from Pune. And coal tar, we get it from Thrissur. So these are all things which we have to identify and source them. And we should use, if possible, lab-grade chemicals. So we get purified chemicals. Earlier, it was very difficult to get this. Now, most of these chemicals are available in the market, and therefore, you can always use them. And it's important to train the youngsters. One person cannot do this because every day around 40 to 50 prescriptions come. So you need multiple. So right now, we have around 5 people who are actually trained in this, and that is why we're getting excellent turnovers, right? So this is passed on from generation to generation. So the newer people are also taught this. So the baton gets passed on to the generation. we need to have a very good storage area, and the storage area should be in very, very scientific, just like a library shelf or a regular pharmacy shelf, because change of prescriptions, the change of concentrations, the labeling is important, the storage is important, the temperature needs to be maintained. All of these need to be taken care of. So you have to have these shelving mechanisms and in a scientific manner. Most of these agents which we are using are hazmat materials, that is hazardous materials. They are inflammable articles. So we need to keep them in separate storage areas where these hazardous materials can be kept. So this is something which we have a cabinet called the hazmat, which is a actually a mandatory requirement for NABH, as an NABH accredited hospital. So we keep all these ingredients. They come and ask us, do you have any hazardous materials? So we keep all this in our outpatient procedure room, as well as we have a similar cupboard in our dispensing lab. So they're all kept very safely, and they are labeled that which are the hazmat items which are there. And we need to also have something called an MSDS sheet or a material safety data sheet, which will tell you in the event that somebody gets hurt by this or gets burnt by this, what should be done, and where is the nearest eye shower available, where is the nearest sink available, how to handle that. Our people are actually trained for that, as to what is to be done in the event that they come and handle. So such training programs take place regularly in the hospital. So that's why all of these, especially anesthetic ether and acetone, are highly inflammable articles. So we tell them to use pottery very carefully in such areas, because a small amount of ether is sufficient. It's a highly inflammable article. It can explode. So we should always be very careful when we are telling them as to how they are to be handled. So quality and safety is very, very important. All safety parameters should be, and you should have a fire extinguisher close by. They should be trained in extinguishing fires. Labeling should be perfect. Dispensing should be done the right way. And all of them should be taught and trained. You should have periodic quality checks. So ask the patient to bring back the prescription and see whether the quality is there. So if you find grains or granules, if it's not mixed properly, if the solution is not prepared properly, ask them to prepare it again. Make sure that you are running the dispensing lab very well. So, and even the storage part should be perfect. So this is now our setup where we are actually passing on from generation to generation. So this is the senior most generation of dermatologists. She is a student of Sudhan sir, and her contemporary was my teacher. And my colleague is now this new dermatologist teacher. So like that, we actually pass it on to the next generation. So that way, this is sustained in our lab. So if you have any doubts and queries, I think you should contact us. But the take-home message is vintage stuff. It's old, but it is treasured, like a Kodak camera. It's old, but precious, like any of these vintage vehicles. And it's old, but useful, just like grandparents for us when they manage our children. So thank you for your patient listening. These days, nobody respects unless anything is distilled and bottled.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot, Abhay. It was indeed an excellent, super excellent, and thoroughly appreciated this thing. Dr. Lalit?
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Please take care of the chat box and questions.
First of all, I wish to congratulate Abhay for your excellent, very novel and spellbound talk. And in today's scenario of pharma-driven practices, this talk of yours was very comforting and assuring, and reiterating the fact that old is still gold, right? So I'm reminded here of Mother Teresa's very famous quote that be faithful in small and simple things. Be faithful in small and simple things, because it is in them that your strength lies. So I think we should all buttress our old strength again, and try to, you know, look into the pharmacoeconomic aspect of the therapy also. So you beautifully highlighted the, you know, role of different galenics like hydrophilic ointments, antipruritic lotion, Castellani's paint in dermatophytosis, gentian violet paint, Whitfield ointment in psoriasis, salicylic acid, sulfur in acne, coal tar and dithrenol, and so many other, you know, agents like calamine lotion, tincture benzoin, etc. Some of them we were using.